Hi, I'm Libby Burke, and I am the research librarian in the Bonneville Power Administration Library. And this is the second disc in our BPA Films DVD set. So during the war, of course, Stephen Kahn, who wrote our films on the first disc, was overseas, and they needed to make a film in 1942. So they got some other people to make the film, and it's a 10 or 11 minute film called Power Builds Ships.
To build ships to carry the war for freedom to a dozen fronts. Ships to sail from 100 ports with food and medicine, tires and tanks. 7 tons of precious cargo for every fighter on battlefields strung halfway around the world.
It was made basically to explain the amazing rapidity with which they were able to build ships during the war. Due to the abundance of electricity and the aluminum plants up and down the Columbia River that were using the hydroelectricity made by the dams. This was very, very important. In fact, the Bonneville Power Act itself of 1937 was looking towards the possibility of having to be in service for a long-range vision toward any kind of national emergency, which would include war production of ships, planes, anything that needed metals and needed a lot of power to run. First BPA Administrator J.D. Ross writes in the first annual report for the year 1938, "Modern warfare is fought in the factory as much as in the air or trenches. America must be ready to meet not only peacetime needs of power for home, farm, and industry, but must be assured of her ability to cope with emergency demands for large blocks of electricity. In the hydroelectric streams of the Pacific Northwest is potential power far in excess of that available in other regions of the nation. It should be developed at an economic rate to meet mounting peacetime needs and the equally important possibilities of emergency drains. Preparedness requires foresight." And so this little movie, which is told in this breathless way, so different from any other BPA film, was sent out to movie theaters, and I have this vision of it kind of fulfilling FDR's desire that all of the men, women, and children in America could see this amazing production in operation because of BPA power. In 1951, BPA made a film called 25,000 Volts Under the Sea, and it was about the engineering and laying of the 7.5 mile undersea cable that was made to bring power from BPA to the San Juan Islands in northwestern Washington. In 1936, the Rural Electrification Act was created, and this was to bring electrification and appliances and conveniences to farms in rural areas. Now, San Juans were considered rural. And at about this time, a lot of people that had gone to the mainland to work had lost their jobs because of the Depression and had to come back to their family farms. So they came back with a knowledge and an understanding of what rural electrification could mean, and set about to form this cooperative called Orcas Power and Light. So in 1937, same year BPA was born, Orcas Power and Light Cooperative was born. But there was no transmission system at that time, so they had to use diesel generators to send out power to the different islands. Now, diesel generators are very expensive to operate and very cumbersome, but their determination was that eventually they would be able to get Bonneville power to the San Juan Islands. So in about 1950, once the transmission system was finished, they were able to start thinking about how to do this. And engineers went to work, and they worked really hard working with researching and planning and working with the weather services to understand how the weather worked in those islands, how the tides worked in those islands, and start to come up with an idea of what type of cable to build and then how to lay it. So in mid-April of 1951, just over a few days, very few day period, this cable was laid. This made national news. It was in Life magazine. The christening was in the newspapers. And then once it was energized in July, that also made national news. So this was a dream come true for the San Juan Islands and a really great story for BPA to tell. The last film in our group is Look to the River, which was made over a period of years and finished in 1954. So this is a really odd film, I think you'll agree. The narration is very low-key, almost Twilight Zone-y. We don't really know who wrote it or who narrated it. It's definitely a different film, trying to tell this story again of the Columbia River Power System. However, it tells the story of the building of these new dams that were coming, Hungry Horse and McNary. The music is very interesting because it was written by Ernest Gold, who at this time was a stock music composer. He wrote scores that would end up in Saturday afternoon serials or low-budget sci-fi films. And this score may well have been on the shelf and purchased to use in this film, but it works really well. And he became an Oscar-winning and award-winning composer. He wrote Exodus and It's a Mad, 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 Mad World. So he became quite well known as a film composer, but we have him much earlier in his career in this film. And there is a great montage of neon, basically a dusk to dawn series of neon signs that is really an interesting use of color photography and also showing, you know, the greatness of the abundance of electricity that we had here in the Northwest. Thank you so much for viewing the historical films from the Bonneville Power Administration. Our library has sponsored this viewing, and we hope that you will get in touch with the Public Information Center if you want more information about the films, and we hope to have more available for you in the future. So thank you so much for your kind attention.